came through my nose.
Fuck this shit. I'm with it now. I don't know what the fuck. Shit's fucking. Fuck this shit! What the hell's going on around here?
People talk about the censorship thing, and I think the best thing with the censorship thing is making a great record, because if you have a great record, people are going to hear it, because it's going to be maybe your next door neighbor playing it to you or whatever, but you can't stop it. If something's good, it doesn't matter if it says fuck shit or beep or what in it, it's going to be good and people are going to like it. And that's our whole thing. And as far as the pay per play, when we started off, we couldn't play anywhere. That's what people said. But we went out, we rented halls, and we put on shows ourselves, you know, passed out flyers. You know, if you're good, you're going to make an audience, you know? People, the big mistake with this whole thing is everyone's trying to give you a tape and saying, we're really good, all we need is someone to hear it. If you're really good, people will hear it, you know? People will be playing it for me and stuff. And it's like, it's unfortunate because everybody's going, I want to be where you're at. Well, first of all, you don't know where the fuck I'm at. Second of all, if you knew where I was at, that's not where you want to be, because basically what people are saying, I want to be a rock star. And if you want to be a rock star, don't try to do what I did, because I did it all wrong, because I don't want to be a rock star. And people say, well, why the fuck are you here? Because I hate people, God damn it!
In the metal world, you just have to say the word suicidal, as you can see in my hat, and everyone pretty much knows what you're on about. And it's not slitting your wrists or wanting to,
fucking kill yourself!
But it is a band! And oddly enough, the lifestyle of suicidal tendencies. A band that is called the very first crossover thrash band. Well, it's either them, SOB, or Carnivore, but that's besides the point. Suicidal tendencies are one of very few bands I can think of that have two, count them, two classic lineups. There's the brash young shitheads that recorded the hardcore early years. And then there's more matured musicians who recorded some of the greatest thrash metal ever put to tape. But whether it's the punk outfit that started it all back in the early 80s, or the lineup that has subsided to the current day, there's only one man that has stayed consistent all the way through the band's lineup. And that one man is Mike Murr Man, the singer who's written some of, if not the best lyrics in all of metal, and even some of the worst. Suicidal Tendencies were formed by Mike Murr Man in Venice, California. The band had a really tough start at first. A local magazine voted them as the worst band and the biggest assholes, and the next year the very same magazine voted them as the very best new band, because fuck consistency, am I right? They were apparently very much involved in gang activity around this time too, but Mike has always denied it. They were banned from playing in LA for either a really crazy show, where they pretty much destroyed the venue, or the above-mentioned gang activity. And now there's a lot of bands that have been banned from venues and stuff. Judas Priest are still banned today from Madison Square Garden. But not many have been banned from an entire city. That's how crazy this band was. Psycho Maiko isn't just a nickname for no reason. There were also some run-ins with the FBI, so to say that this band was a pariah was an understatement. But during all of the grief the band had to deal with in the early days, they recorded one of the all-time greatest hardcore punk albums of all time.
Of all fucking time.
Now, the debut Suicidal Tendencies record is one of those albums that are almost hard to review, because everyone already knows that this album's a masterpiece. I mean, hell, show me a weak song for this album and I'll show you a feces-throwing retard. From the first song off the album, Suicide's an Alternative, You'll Be Sorry, regardless of their name, are here to give you some inspiration to fucking live. A trend that has survived to this current day with the band. Two-sided politics. I'm not anti-society, society's anti-me. I'm not anti-religion, religion is anti-me. I'm not anti-anything, I just want to be free. Now that's a way to live your life. Now this album is definitely a punk album, first and foremost. You could call it crossover, but I don't hear much thrash or even metal on this album. It's pure punk rock to my ears. Subliminal is a great mid-tempo song with an almost doomy riff before blasting off to the usual hardcore-ness that you hear from the rest of the album. But I love how it'll go from the mid-tempo verse to the hardcore chorus without you even noticing a change in direction. Now that's pure genius. And of course, Institutionalized, the last craze for Holiday in Cambodia, or I Want to Be Sedated of Suicidal's discography. Now, they have had bigger hits than this song in terms of both sales and chart performance, like You Can't Bring Me Down or Hate You Better, you know, songs like that, but none of those songs even come close to how iconic the song is. It's a touchstone of not only punk, but music in general, with every half would think they're funny for being the same old, stale jokes about Mike wanting a Pepsi, including myself. The longest track of this album is I Saw Your Mommy, which is almost 5 minutes, which for hardcore standards is a full-blown epic. And honestly, it feels like it. No shit, it takes you on a ride and you'll be bopping your head every step of the fucking way. But honestly, my favorite songs of the album would have to be the shorter tracks, as much as I love the longer numbers. I Shut the Devil opens up with Mike screaming, I SHUT REGAN! Which, according to rumors, was originally supposed to be the original title of the song, but after meeting with the FBI, they had to change it. Man, Psycho Mike just can't catch a break, can he? But ultimately, they changed the name and made the song more of a diss towards Reagan than even the original title, comparing him to the devil and all. Then there's Fascist Pig, which is about smashing the fash, but ultimately much less cringy than some of the shit we have now. I like how they change it up and make it, I will be the fascist pig. I'm gonna fuck everybody up. Just changing it like that, it still condemns fascists, but it's nowhere near as cringy. I Want More actually features Mike singing, like actually singing, not just assaulting your fucking eardrums with screams and shrieks. And Suicidal Failure is kind of like Megadeth's Skin on My Teeth.
But better.
I mean, what can I say? I love this album. Gun to my head, I have to say it's my favorite Suicidal album. But what do you expect? I'm more of a punk guy than a metal guy. I mean, you see the Ramones album right there. It is by no means a slight on the rest of the band's discography, because, as we'll discuss, that's some of the finest metal ever pressed to a big, black piece of vinyl. But anyway, after the debut came out, the band went on a little bit of a hiatus, the first of many, may I add. During this time, the label Suicidal Records was founded, and Mike formed the band called Los Psychos, or some bullshit, with Suicidal bassist Luigi Maioria? Is that it? Fuck, no, no. It fills with all Norwegian bands he had to fucking review. But the point is they kept themselves busy while they put ST to the side. But when they came back, they hit back fucking hard. Now by the time 1987 came around, the original lineup split like a motherfucker. Luigi, or however you say his name, is still there. Mike's obviously is still there. But Amory Smith ditched, which left room for RJ Herrera, I believe it's pronounced, who would stay with the band for a good 8 years. Grandeste Estes Ests left, which therefore brought in one of the greatest guitar players of his time. Rocky fucking George. A man whose guitar will pierce your eardrums, but in a good way. He honed his chops in a hardcore band called Pap Smear with Jack Adamant of Slayer fame before joining ST, and with all due respect to every other member, he pretty much made his era of Suicidal worth listening to. The man was a beast, and was pretty much the reason the band went from punk to metal. He is the Rocky Balboa of metal guitar. But on this album, the band is definitely in a transitional stage of being full-blown punk or being full-blown thrash. So this album is arguably the most crossover album in Suicidal's entire discography, because nearly everything else they've ever done, let's be honest, is either punk or metal. There isn't much in between besides this album right here. which is one of the reasons it took me so long to get into this album. It isn't very straightforward, even though War Inside My Head was actually the very first Suicidal song I ever heard, but it was the, in my opinion, inferior version of Still Psycho after all these years. And speaking of that song, my word, is it a fucking classic. It's a song about controlling your thoughts, being at peace. I mean, it's catchy, the riff is great. The album starts off amazingly with Suicidal Maniac, which you can only assume is about the motherfucker on the front cover of the album. Join the Army is a slow, sludging song, a song about joining the Suicidal Army, not the US Army, and also living the suicidal lifestyle. And though the suicidal lifestyle isn't about being Little Miss Kelly McSlitz himself or whatever the fuck, it's about being yourself, not giving a fuck, and taking care of yourself. Which is very punk in attitude, of just being yourself and who gives a fuck. Which is why it's my favorite song of the album. Possessed to Skate is probably the most successful song off the album. They made a video for it like they did with Institutionalized since it was a bit of a hit on MTV. So they tried to make Lightning Strike twice, and even though it didn't quite work like they probably wanted to, it still is up there as one of the more popular ST songs. The most different song off this album is A Little Each Day, the longest song being just over 4 minutes, and it feels like an epic, despite the running length. I guess you could call it the first suicidal ballad in some ways because of the depressing lyrics and Rocky's incredible emotional guitar solo, but either way, it doesn't matter how you really cut it or slice it, it's still great. So overall, Join the Army was a fantastic album, which saw the band spreading their wings and showing everyone that they weren't just another hardcore punk band. And before we go into How Will I Laugh, we need to quickly talk about a man called No Mercy. No, not that No Mercy. This No Mercy. God, I hate that they took that name. Now, this band was founded by a man named Mike Clark, along with some other people that no one even knows or cares about. And for years, all they did was release a few songs and some skateboarding compilations, until our beloved Mike Mirman had some downtime between Suicidal albums and sang the very first and last official studio album, Widespread Bloodshed Love Runs Red. And this album is just classic crossover. Sure, it ain't perfect, the production sounds quite unfinished, which is why Mike sounds like he's trapped in the bottom of a well for most of the album, and there's little to no bottom to speak of, but hey, it's crossover thrash, what were you expecting? After the album was done, the band was already in the writing stages of what would be their second album. But the rest of the band went Splitsville, which left Mike Clark and Mike Muir with a bunch of bitchin' songs, but no band to play them in. So what they do? Have Clark join Suicidal as dream guitarist, and use the material that they had written for No Mercy for the next ST album.
How will I laugh tomorrow when I can't even smile today? You gotta explain this, because this is very much what the band is about, right?
Yeah. Basically, it's, confusing, I guess, because everyone has a hard time saying it. But to us, it means something. To other people, it may not mean anything. But basically, you know, when you get down to it, some people say they want to be rich, they want to be this and that. Most important thing in the world is being happy. And I mean, if you're not happy today, you're not going to wake up and be happy tomorrow. And we take that in a positive approach and say, well, you know, if you're not happy, you need to do something about it. And you know, there's a lot of things that may happen in your life which may be bad luck or may not seem to be fair, but you have to take that and, you know, work towards being happy, because that's the bottom line. And the most important thing in the world is being happy. And it's something you have to work for, but it's something that's worth working for.
Now, this is the album where the band finds themselves going from punk to crossover thrash, to just plain thrash. You may be thinking, but I hear plenty of punk elements on this album. But here's the thing, thrash in itself is a very close genre to punk as it is. So those punk elements come with the territory of thrash, I mean, let's be honest here. Bands like Metallica and Overkill had a shit ton of punk elements in their early material, but no one calls them crossover thrash. People only really call it ST crossover because they went from punk to thrash. But here's the thing, they went from pure punk to pure thrash, with Join the Army being the only real crossover album they made in their classic years. But enough of the nerdy shit that we get into way too much of in these retrospectives. Sorry, it's kind of given at this point, you should have realized. How Will I Laugh is seminal thrash metal. the band's first album on a major label, and it sounds like it. This is a much more precise version of Suicidal than on the first two albums, with Mike Clark fitting in like a glove, which I didn't know why they kept him solely as a rhythm player, since if you listen to No Mercy, you would know that the guy can wail like nobody's business. Now granted, he's nowhere near the level of Rocky in terms of lead playing, but I'm sure he could have dropped a few leads here or there. But with that being said, Clark played a pivotal role as rhythm guitarist, as well as just being an overall songwriter in the band. And some people seem to forget how important a good rhythm guitarist can be. It can counter a good lead guitar when needed, it keeps the riff anchored in place, and it gives the lead guitarist real freedom to really play as they really want. And Clark fit all those boxes to a fucking T, on top of just having great rhythm technique. But the classic lineup isn't there just yet, since the bassist on this album, Bob Heathcote, isn't anything special. Now sure, he has some cool fills on Trip the Brain, but that's really it. He's just there for the most part, with his creepy fucking pedo stash. Another way the song differentiates itself is that it has the very first Suicidal ballad. I've said it once and I'll say it again, ST's ballads are always amazing. And this first one is no exception. The title track, How Can I Laugh Tomorrow When I Can't Even Smile Today? Fuck, that is a long title. This song is amazing, and as inspirational as ST can be with their lyrics and how happy they can be at times, they understand that sometimes you simply just can't be happy, whether that due to mental illness or whatever. I remember being at the height of my depression and blasting the shit out of the song. It's a song that describes pretty well just by the title alone. But like the quote you see at the end of one of the videos for the song, sometimes the hardest thing to admit is that someone really does care. And that shit is true as fuck. And also a really melancholy song of this album is Sorry? A song that I believe is about an ex of Mike's that's trying to get back with him, but he said no, she ended up killing herself, and that's why there's both exclamation marks and question marks, because he doesn't know quite how to feel. Like, sorry this happened to you, but maybe I shouldn't be sorry, because it isn't my fault you decided to fucking kill yourself just because I didn't want to get back together. And even though the song's pure thrash, the emotion still comes out clear as a bell, especially with the line, she died, but it's killing me. That lyric right there really resonates with me. But hey, at the end of the day, this is a thrash album. It isn't all just melancholy. Pledge Your Allegiance is basically Join the Army Part 2, but still great. In fact, it's arguably even better. Trip of the Brain is the most popular song, for good reason. It's up-tempo, catchy, and it's a great song to mosh to. I'm playing every mosh before in my fucking life. Surfer Slam kind of takes possess the skates thing and talking about a sport, but this time it's an instrumental, and a great one at that. And the feelings back is unbelievably catchy, with amazing guitar work which almost harmonizes with the vocals. Overall, it's an amazing album, maybe the best thrasher or Suicidal album, I'm not sure, I have to think about it. And even though it didn't exactly set the world on fire sales-wise, it did put the band on the trajectory to make 3 gold-selling discs, which makes them actually the highest-selling thrash band outside of the Big Four. Which granted isn't saying very much, but still, it's kind of impressive. So next time everyone goes, Exodus should be in the Big Five, Overkill should be in the Big Five. Look, even if there ever was a Big Five, which there never will be, it should be Suicidal, if anybody. The first of these gold-selling albums is the Controlled by Hatred Feel Like Shit EP, which I honestly don't exactly know why it went gold, since it's just mostly re-recordings of No Mercy songs along with 2 different versions of How Will I Laugh. One's the single version, which is a neutered version because it cuts out the entire second section of the song, which is blasphemy in my opinion. Then there's the autistic version of the song, dubbed the heavy emotional version. And I think this is the reason it went gold. The trendies who couldn't handle heavy Suicidal could pick this up and get a soft, but still fantastic version of one of their songs. And there's also a couple of originals, which are pretty good for what they are. And around this time, they also got bassist Robert Trujillo, who later joined another band, but I'm not sure if you've ever heard of them. They're kind of cult and niche, and they're not for everybody.
Lights, Camera, Revolution, the new album from Suicidal Tendencies, Thinking as Hard as They Play.
Latest Suicidal Tendencies record, Lights, Camera, Revolution, which I imagine is your best record in sales so far, right?
Think so.
So Suicidal Tendencies fans are growing. I mean, there's definitely getting more and more of them out there.
Yeah. Selling more records than Michael Jackson.
The talk radio guy.
Alliance Camera Revolution is for good reason considered the magnum opus of Suicidal's discography. As the only full-length albums that feature what is considered the classic lineup, it's not only their highest-selling album, but it's also their highest-selling thrash album not released by any of the big four. I mean, this album is classic as fuck. Send Me Your Money, Give It Revolution, Alone, Don't Break Down, You Can't Bring Me Down, the ultimate fuck you to anybody trying to bring you down in any which way possible. And Suicidal knew all about this shit at that point. They were banned from playing LA, a huge market for metal bands that runs with the law. They got shit for changing genres, they got shit for their name. I think they got struck by lightning a few times too, to add insult to injury. The point is, the song is the band saying, I don't give a fuck what you think, we're doing what we want, and you can't bring me down, motherfucker. Can you say feel like shit? Yeah, maybe sometimes I do feel like shit. I ain't happy about it, but I'd rather feel like shit than be full of shit. And if I offended you, oh, I'm sorry, but maybe you need to be offended. But here's my apology and one more thing. Then we have Lost Again, a great mid-tempo gem, Alone, my favorite Suicidal ballad, and one of their best songs ever fucking period. From what I understand, it's about depression and loneliness. The line, I feel so alone in a room full of people, really strikes a nerve with people like me. And for depressed people, it's true as fuck. And some people who don't get it are always like, oh, I understand. No, you don't understand. People who understand, really understand, don't have to say it, because they know. There's also some funk elements on this album, mainly due to Rob Chihiro's input because he has a funk background. Like Lovely, a song that has this consistent rhythm throughout that you think you get sick of, but actually, I feel lovely. There's also Give Me Your Money, a kind of humorous song that takes aim at televangelists begging for your hard-earned shekels to secure your spot in heaven. Where's the other thing? Yeah, I can't remember. The final track, Go and Breakdown, might just be the catchiest motherfucking song they ever wrote. It's a song that goes down great live. Just an excuse for our yarns to scream, BREAKDOWN! It's got some great lyricisms from Mike, amazing solos and riffs from Ronky George. It's everything great about Suicidal all contained into one song. Check it. Now after Lights Camera release, the band did their fair share of touring, including opening for bands such as Queensryche in the Empire era, and Jane's Addiction, which was kind of odd. But speaking of Jane's Addiction, their drummer, Stephen Perkins, formed a band with Rob and Mike. It's a play to make your booty move, it's the Infectious Grooves. And with album titles like that, the band name, in general, is safe to assume we're dealing with some funk metal. And for the most part, I believe the band was just an excuse for, one, Rob to show off his bass skills, and two, for Mike to act just plain simple silly. And overall, the band is much more lighthearted than traditional Suicidal, with the exception of an excellent diss towards Rage Against the Communists, I mean Machine. But after Mike and Rob did their little bit of experimentation with Infectious Grooves, longtime drummer Archie Herrera was quitting the band after almost a decade with them. It would be safe to assume with the next album, we'd be getting a very different Suicidal Tendencies.
Suicidal Tendencies, who for years had their look, lyrics, and very name keeping them outside the music mainstream, now find themselves almost respectable as they tour in support of their sixth album, The Art of Rebellion.
A couple years ago, the majority of them major chain stores wouldn't carry our records simply because of our name. And we have to battle with certain things like that. You know, right now we're getting played on the radio, which is something that's taken 10 years for us to happen.
But adversity still follows the band. A few days into the tour, guitarist Ronky George severed the tip of a finger during a run-in with a door. George was rushed to the hospital and skin grafted onto the tip of the finger. He played the following night. Here's
Now, The Art of Rebellion is what you'd call a hot mess. A surprisingly good hot mess, and one I actually listen to a lot, but a hot mess all the same. I mean, who wanted an experimental Suicidal Tendencies? I don't know about you guys, but when I put on a Suicidal album, I'm not yearning for them to pull my pen and jump from genre to genre like a game of hopscotch. When people listen to this band, they know exactly what they want. And though it may differ from time to time, being hardcore punk or thrash metal, it's still very aggressive music. Even though this album can definitely be aggressive, no one's gonna jump into the pit when Asleep at the Wheel is playing, I can assure you. It really boggles my mind that they decide to follow up Lights, Camera, Revolution, a landmark of thrash metal, with this. That's like Metallica following up Master of Puppets with Load. And say what you want about any of those albums, but the fact of the matter is that these albums in question sound radically different from each other. My point being is that it usually takes bands several albums to really fuck up their sound this bad. But not counting the groove that makes your booty move, Suicidal did it with one album. Come to think of it, it's actually kind of impressive. Mike Clark said that it was not planned to be such an experimental album, that it was just a natural musical growth, which I can believe considering how much of a clusterfuck that the album turned out to be. Like I mentioned before, RJ Herrera left the band before the recording of this album, so they got Josh Freese to fill in. If you're a fan of music, I guarantee you, you've heard this man's drumming in some place or another. He played on literally hundreds of albums. You may have heard of his work with A Perfect Circle, Guns N' Roses, Social Distortion. Fuck, he's even played with pop divas like Avril Lavigne and Katy Perry. This guy's all over the map. And even though the guy's undoubtedly a good drummer, and he's played on some stuff that I fucking love, Harji Herrera has one hell of a groove to his playing, and Josh is just another pounding rock drummer. Not to mention, RJ actually helped write. Not much granted, but he always left his mark. But Josh is just purely a session musician, and the band was a four-piece at this time. So, fuck. Then we have the production. Now, not only did people not want experimental Suicidal, they did not want a clean and polished Suicidal. This album was produced by Peter Collins, who produced Queensrÿche's Empire. Oh fuck. Some of Rush's worst synth offerings, and an album we've already discussed in the Alice Cooper retrospective, Hey Stupid. And what do all these albums have in common? Overproduction. I mean, just listen to Mike Mirren's voice in this album. It's so overprocessed. He went from sounding like Lemmy to trying to sound like Jeff Tate's skater cousin. Even on heavier tracks, his voice sticks out like a sore thumb. And it's on full display on the lead single, Nobody Hears. Which is a song that kind of goes against the nature of the band. It isn't uplifting in any way. It isn't inspiring. It's sad and depressing. Some might hate it for that reason, but fuck, it's still a really good song like every other Suicidal ballad. What can I say? And when the album gets heavier, sometimes it has a tendency to be on the forgettable side. But the best song on the album, in my opinion, at least, is the catchiest fuck, Accept My Sacrifice. You know that something ain't right. It's a sacrifice. Why must I pay this price? Accept my sacrifice. Then we hit filler like Taverns of Power, or Monopoly on Sorrow, which is slightly better. We call it Smother Revenge, which is really just mindless for Suicidal standards. But the two latter, I guess, would fall into the killer fillers categories. I Wasn't Meant to Feel This, / Asleep at the Wheel, isn't as bad as it probably should be. I mean, it takes you on a really weird trip whenever you hear it, with Mike Mirren being the grand conductor of this really weird ride you're going on with this song. You're asleep at the wheel. Gotta Kill Captain Stupid is more or less traditional Suicidal that could have fit on Lights, Camera, though granted with a better production. I'll Hit You Better is such an odd song that I can't help but love it. One second you'll hear some bluesy licks and it'll be all mel, then BAM! You get a chugging riff with Mike screaming in your face about how he'll hit you better. Whatever the fuck that means. And last three tracks are good, I guess. Like, again, they're killer filler. But at the end of the day, filler is filler. So Art of Rebellion, overall, is not bad, far from it. Arguably, it has some of the best songwriting from the band to date. It's a much more mature version of the band, but it ended up being career suicide. Suicide. Oh god, that sounds bad out of context. Now after the Art of Rebellion and the backlash they received for the mature act of stepping outside of the box, they released Lil Psycho after all these years, a complete re-recording of the first landmark album with two songs from Join the Army that was made during the Lights, Camera, Revolution sessions. And it was done because Mike got fucked over by the label that released the album, and he, along with the rest of the OG lineup, weren't getting any royalties from it, so they re-recorded it. Something a lot of bands have done since.
Now, you're going to be releasing the Still Psycho After All These Years album, which you re-recorded during the Lights, Camera, Revolution sessions. Why have you decided to do that?
Money!
And what I think of it? It's an album of re-recordings. I mean, those very rarely are in high esteem of fucking anyone, especially in cases like this, where there's only one original member and it misses the charm of the original album almost entirely. I'll admit, if the original album never came out and this was just another Suicidal album, I'd probably like it better. But at the end of the day, this is an album of subpar re-recordings done for the sake of money and sounds like it.
In the middle 80s in Hollywood, everybody had their hair floofed up and everybody had that little look. And you walk down there now and everyone has their hair all raggedy and they got the Doc Martens and the cutoff, you know, things and stuff. So it's just fashion. This fashion always changes. And a lot of people like to be assholes. They like to tell people what to do, you know? And they want to be in a position where, oh, we want to yell at people and stuff. So how do you do that? You become a rock star. How do you become a rock star? Basically, you give the masses what they want. What is that? Lies. It's like politicians.
Suicidal for Life is what you call a gross overcorrection. They made an album very experimental that fucked with the sound. Some people liked it, but a lot of people didn't. It goes without saying that they were not going to advance in that situation and explore their sound in other interesting ways. Say what you want about Art of Rebellion, but the sound was genuine. They wanted to do that. They weren't pressured into doing something unnatural for them. Unlike this album sounds like the band trying to be their former selves.
Hey, people like their thrash metal material, let's make it thrashy. People liked it when we swore, let's swear like sailors.
Oh yeah, maybe the most ridiculous thing about this album is that half the tracks have swears in the title. They don't just have swears in general, they have swears in the fucking title. I don't give a fuck, no fucking problem, Suicidal motherfucker, fucked up just right, no bullshit, what's the fucking point? Both Suicidal was sharply written and Mike Muir's lyrics were always superb. And sure, there was an F-bomb here or there, don't get me wrong, but there was always purpose for it. To add to the intensity or to just make a point. This just sounds like an edgy teenager who swears all the time for no reason. They don't make it sound natural in a sentence, they just say it to sound cool. They only have the lead single, Love vs. Loneliness. Why make the ballad the lead single? I mean, it's an okay song, but why? You want to make a statement that Heavy Suicidal is back, then you have this as a single? It's almost as if you wanted this album to fail. Why not make No Fucking Problem the lead single? The title may be dumb, but it makes a statement, it's catchy, has a great riff, and it's plenty of classic Mike Muir bravado. So why not this song? Or write this wearing. Fiddlesticks. You talk your shit, but I ain't listening. And I don't do no ass kissing. Now here's a point that you've been missing. No fucking problem at all. Then there's the other single, What You Need's a Friend. Again, it's far from awful, but I can't help but listen to this song and laugh. Thanks, in-betweeners.
Oh, friend! Friend! Fucking fucking friend!
Overall, Suicidal for Life is a very bleh album, despite what Metal Archives may tell you. It has some nice moments by the end with depression, anguish, and evil, but getting there is a real chore. And it's a shame, because this is the last album of the band's classic period since the band split up for a while after this album. Oh boy, now we've looked at great albums in this retrospective, we've seen mediocre albums, we've even seen downright bizarre albums, but nothing has been outright bad. Sure, some albums are more objective than others, but we have yet to see trash. Until right the fuck now! Now after Suicidal for Life broke up the band for about 10 minutes, and unfortunately when the band came back to reunite, there was barely a band left. Jimmy DeGrasso was playing with MD45 album along with Dave Mustaine and Leaving of Fear, and later ended up joining Megadeth for about a nanosecond. Rob Chio was playing from some singer with from Black Sabbath, which... what was it again? Oh, you're right! It was Tony Martin. And my boy, Rocky George, for my money, one of the greatest guitarists of thrash, left and went on to play with a bunch of bands, most notably the Cro-Mags, leaving only the two mics of the band, Murr and Clark. So to fill out the lineup, we have Josh Paul on bass, Brooks Wackerman on drums, and Dean Pleasance, who is Psycho Faithful, recognized for his time with Infectious Grooves. And it was probably the best jokes that could have gone for a lead guitarist. He can play Rocky's material fine, and he's worked with Mike before. And fuck, he's still in the band now, so what does that tell you? On Freedom, the band decided to take the regressive nature of Suicide for Life and crank it up to 10 and go back to hardcore punk. For some reason. Probably due to the rise of bands like Green Day and The Offspring setting off a punk revival in the mainstream. So we have a bunch of middle-aged men trying to recapture the fire that they had in their youth playing this aggressive style of music, and it's fucking awful. Especially going back to hardcore? I mean, the main thing that got popular was pop punk. Pop punk. Sure, they're both punk genres, but hardcore and pop punk are two very different things. I mean, sure, Smash may be the highest selling fucking independent label album ever, but I think we can all agree that was a goddamn anomaly that that album sold as much. Mike sounds slow, he can barely keep up, he sounds like he's constantly out of breath, and the band doesn't really help him much. It sounds like people who don't know how to write punk music writing punk music. Now I know that the punk genre is fairly simplistic, I'm aware of this, but it's harder to write this music than most people will give it credit for. It may be technically easy to write, just play blistering power chords and scream about your problems, right? Wrong! It may be easy to write, but it's really hard to write and make it good. You don't have a lot of components to work with in punk music, but it's about taking what you have and making something spectacular. Like when you're making a sandwich, you don't have a lot of ingredients to work with most of the time. It's really hard to make something more than just bland and average. And when people do punk music right, you get the germs, you get the damned, you get the sentence. It's basically the equivalent of a fucking great meatball sub. But when you fuck up punk music, you get Flipper, you get La Tigre, you get Good Charlotte, you get Suicidal Tendencies Freedom, which is basically just fucking two slabs of fucking bread that are stale, along with a goddamn slab of meats that isn't even or anything, just those fucking two things together. And sure, it might fill you up for the time being, but it certainly won't make you want to go back to it anytime soon. And Freedom, what a terrible pun. And just look at this album cover. This is an album pre-made for the bargain bin. Freedom of expression, just load of shit. Just in a fight in American politics. Fuck. People say this album sucks purely because they're old and they're trying to play punk music, and it's a genre that thrives off of young energy, which I disagree with. Sure, most of the best punk music is made by the adolescents, it seems. But even older people can out-punk even the most youthful out there. What about bands like Off? The band has released three great hardcore punk albums, and everyone in the band is actually older than what Suicidal was at this time. No, fucking Keith Morris is about as old as the Crypt Keeper. So in my opinion, the getting old argument really carries very little weight. The band just phoned it in here, let's be honest. I can't even pick a real favorite track, all the songs are just congealed together, one cohesive piece of mediocre music. I mean, some tracks kind of break the monotony, like Heaven or Naked, which reminds me of Art of Rebellion, actually. And a lot of people seem to like Hippie Killer, which I'll concede is one of the better tracks, with a funny premise that Eric Carmen would certainly approve of.
Here's some joints, and a guitar.
Overall, Freedom is not the worst thing in the world, sure. I mean, it's better than most punk revival albums. That's not exactly high praise. I mean, look, if Suicidal rest for a few years, went to a more traditional crossover direction, then we should be alright.
Fuck! Reason it saves my mind. You wish you did, I feel like I'm dying. This a price you pay for love. I feel so unforgettable fun. Reason it saves my mind. Everything I can think of, I'm trying.
Free Your Soul and Save My Mind, otherwise known as Freedom Part 2 Electric Boogaloo. I mean, what else do you expect when a band records two albums back-to-back in two consecutive years? Which makes no sense because the band couldn't even do that in their early years. What makes them think they can even do it here? I mean, why did they even think about doing that? Was it because the first album was received so good? Yeah, probably not. This album, make no mistake, is just a copy-paste of Freedom. I could take my review of Freedom used for this album and you probably wouldn't even notice. Only here's the thing, it may be Freedom Part 2, but it's actually even worse. Wow, a sequel worse than the original. What a fucking shock. Probably the epicenter of this shit Sunday is pop songs. I mean, the production sounds like a fart, the snare drum sounds like a cowbell. I mean, it's a song about insulting pop songs and fads, but the song itself is far more insulting than any pop song I've heard in recent memory. And don't even get me started on the lyrics.
I hate Puff Daddy and his friend, the Dead Fatty.
Damn, I thought we were fucking edgy. And Mike, I wouldn't exactly be so liberal in calling others fat because you're not exactly Ricky Martin anymore either, buddy.
And if I hear another love ballad, I think I'm gonna have to toss my salad in.
Fucking kill me. Now, during the majority of the 2000s, Suicidal was in a weird place. Meaning, they were around, sure, they weren't breaking up, they were touring and everything, but it seemed like that's all they were doing. Mainly because that's all they were fucking doing. They traded out members too many times to count. The only real notable thing they did was record another album full of re-recordings, which consisted mostly of songs from Join the Army as well as some No Mercy songs, which is probably better than Still Psycho after all these years because of a raw production, but still pointless as my penis. Then in 2012, Mike Clark suffered a concussion which hospitalized him and ended up with him leaving the band, which really sucks because that guy was always such a big part of their sound and was always a great contributor in terms of writing. But thankfully, he left his mark on the upcoming album from Suicidal Tendencies, an album that had been in development since the early 2000s. It was the Chinese democracy of thrash metal. And when it came out, everyone agreed that it was okay. It's just okay.
Okay, did you have any idea when you started Suicidal Tendencies that you would end up giving birth to skate punk, crossover thrash, and funk metal?
Nah, because it didn't really exist, and you know, I wasn't really worried about it. I think one of the things is it was just doing what I liked, you know. And as my dad said, if someone else does something you don't like it, you're twice as bad as doing that. So I didn't do what I didn't like. Didn't worry about people liked it. We didn't think anyone would like it anyhow. Weren't worried about the rules, and you know. So when the first record came out, you know, all the punk fans even said it was terrible. And then four years later, then it became a punk rock classic, and our second one was terrible. So, you know, that's just the way that it always goes when you do something differently, and people don't like that, you know.
Step up from Freedom and Save Your Soul, but it isn't quite the return to form that this band needed at this point. Especially after making fans wait a decade for it, you can't help but feel disappointed. Most of the tracks kinda just run together, and it's really easy to lose interest. Mike Clark is definitely missed here. It just sounds like he's just another Suicidal album. By incorporating ancient memes, writing songs about being psycho, and slamming, it just comes across as fairly hollow. And the name doesn't exactly help matters. I mean, 13? Really? Are you guys that out of ideas? This isn't even your 13th album unless you got all those stupid EPs and compilations that no one cares about. And not to mention how generic and bland the name is for how many metal bands have used this album, before and since. I mean, what's the point? I know 13 is considered a spoopy number in some circles, but why do so many metal bands have to use it for their albums? I guess the most interesting thing about the album is that it's definitely the most crossover album that they have done since Join the Army, since most of their other albums afterwards mostly just fall into thrash metal, like I've already fucking said before. But regardless of how meh I regard this album, I still say that they made a great statement with the opening track, Shake It Out. There's also a funny line which shows Mike becoming kind of self-aware.
Someone please give me a diet Pepsi. You can return to
sender. Fuck, give me one moment, I'll be right back. Okay, so I couldn't find a diet Pepsi, I don't think they make those anymore, at least here. So this should be the next best thing, it's Pepsi Max. Okay, let's try it.
Hey, what's going on, party people? It's your boy Snack Dubs
back again with another legit food review.
Why do people buy this? Why do people drink this? Jesus fucking Christ. Now, after 13 happened, the band just did what they always did, and since it took a decade to get an album out of them last time, no one is really holding their breath for ST to release a new album anytime soon, including myself. But then out of nowhere, it was announced that the legend from Slayer, Dave Lombardo, would be joining the band. Which is a total shock for me, for someone like Lombardo to join Suicidal. Because you never saw Paul McCartney join the Rolling Stones, you never saw Ace Frehley join Aerosmith. These things very rarely happen. So of course, this got everyone in the metal community fucking excited, including myself. Especially after announcing a full-length album with Lombardo playing drums. God dang, my fucking boner was erect as a motherfucker.
I mean, everybody has been very supportive of my contribution to Suicidal and my participation in the band. And I'm very grateful, you know, being in this position where I'm performing with such a legend like, you know, Mike Muir.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've known Mike for many years, you know, Slayer and Suicidal go back. You know, back in the early 80s, yeah, I remember seeing Suicidal back in 82, you know, at some of the some show in California. And this was before we toured with them. And, you know, I've been a fan since.
Then when that album came out, I absolutely, positively, splendiferously did not think much of it. I don't know why, it just felt weird to me. I didn't understand why the opening track was a callback to their hardcore roots and referencing Ozzy of all people. And the title, how does one clap like Ozzy? Is it something like this? And the rest of the album just kind of went in one ear and out the other. I never really touched the album again until getting bitched at by Massa for airing my feelings for the album. Which prompted me to give another chance. And as soon as I heard the second single, Living for Life, with a fresh pair of ears,
it'll be a fight to the end! It's a fight to the end!
God dang, I'm gonna regret that. Holy fuck, this album's fucking great. Talk about a sleeper album, my god. And the great songs don't just stop there. Happy Never After. This has a melody that is so fucking sinister, I love it. The New Degeneration is a call to arms for a new generation of metal fans. And the closing track, my god. This World, a re-recording of a track from 13, but Jesus Christ, I don't care because fuck, as far as I'm concerned, this is the definitive version of the song without a doubt. It's an amazing slow burn, which is something you wouldn't expect from this band, but that just makes it even better.
This world don't deserve my. This world don't deserve my. This world don't deserve my love. This world don't deserve my love.
But my favorite song is definitely Get Your Fight On. The only song on the album that wasn't solely written by Mike, being co-written by Dean Pleasance. My god, Get Your Fight On is without a doubt the best song they've done since Going Breakdown from Lights, Camera, Revolution. It's got Mike being strangely political with his lyrics, which some people may scoff at, but Mike is much smarter than most people give him credit for, since he can be crazy and kind of goofy at times. But let's not forget, this is the man who screamed, "I shot Reagan," in 1983. This is the man who's calling for revolution in 1990 as George Bush Sr. was sworn into office. My point being is that the band was no stranger to politics. And unlike the song I Shot the Devil, which pretty much outlined exactly what Mike thought about Reagan, Get Your Fight On can be interpreted no matter how you may lean on the political spectrum. It's a song to encourage you to actually give a shit about what's going on in the world and take a stand, when there's so many people out there who just don't care, and that's what most of these politicians want. They don't want you to pay attention to what's going on. They want to keep you ignorant. The song tells you to get your fight on because, to quote Mike Muir himself, sometimes you gotta fight with your fists, sometimes you gotta fight with your mind.
Let's get a fight on! As long as we move, as long as we breathe. And get your right on! As long as we live, we'll always believe. Now get your right on! As long as we breathe, we'll always believe. And get your fight on!
But if I have to be honest, the album is kind of top-heavy. But fuck, most albums are top-heavy, so don't hold that against it. And even then, not only do I think Get Your Fight On is the best song this band has done since Going Breakdown, I think this is the best album they have done by far since Lights, Camera, Revolution. Maybe it was Mike getting his head into the game, maybe it was Dave Lombardo's involvement, or maybe it was the two new members rounding out their lineup.
So that puts an end to the Suicidal Tendencies discography.
A band who helped pioneer multiple genres of music, sold millions of albums, and persevered throughout the years to become the quintessential band of crossover thrash. And even though they had about two decades of making, well, let's just say mediocre music, with Dave Lombardo joining the band, they seem to have found their groove again, with World Gone Mad being their best record in many, many years. And I don't know about you, but I am very excited to see what comes next for Suicidal Tendencies.